It is, if this one is rather straight, but if you look at this one, it's placed on an angle, and if you lose all the solder joints at the same time and it drops off, then it can be hard to put it at the same distance and at the same angle. The same if you have components like MOSFETs that are mounted on a PCB and screwed to a heat sink. If you have to replace the MOSFETs and you put it in there, then you can have the problem that if you bend it up, that the hole does not line up. In that case, first screw the part to the cooling thing, do the legs on the right place, and then tack them or solder them if possible. Sometimes it's a bit difficult, but then you tack one or two legs and then you can put everything apart so that you can access the solder joints if the cool thing is gone, the cool profile. So that is and in this case the solder joints are not really bad, but they are also not too fresh, so I remove most of the solder and then I resolder the rest, and then I can exclude some of the problems that can cause problems. So that's always a good thing to do. Did I solder this one? Yeah. I have not cleaned it yet, and I often don't do that while I'm soldering, because then sometimes you don't know which components you already have replaced or tested. I can see that then on the solder. Often it's just to see because they're nice, new and shiny. Resistors don't often go bad. You can, if you don't trust things, you can of course measure them. It's also easy often to test semiconductors, because they can go wrong, and then it's suddenly, if you turn on your meter, it doesn't want to go on because its batteries are dead. So I have to reload that. No problem, I have more meters. The good thing from the Agilent is that it beeps when you are testing semiconductors. If it's conducting, they beep one time, and if it's short, they stay beeping. And that's easy on the, I call it, Brymen. You have to look on the meter. Straight away, yeah. And then if you don't know how the pins are connected, then just do some combinations. In circuit is not always a good thing. 0.66 for this one, and then probably the base in the middle here, and 0.66 for the other one, and no connection between the emitter and the you see here one, but it's through the other parts. So the transistor here is okay. And that's always things to remember. There are always things parallel. Parts that can go wrong are potentiometers, not so much this ones, but the ones like on this. So I often like to check them. Now I use the two multimeter probes. It's often more easy to find some place where you can hook it up, and then they turn the thing while you are looking at it. First thing is the total resistance. It is 100 ohms. And if I remember from the other one, that is correct. And if this is the loper, then you need to see 61 here and that, and 45 the other way, so together that makes 100 ohm. And if you really want to be sure, you can tack solder something to it just for one short time. And if you're handy with your probes and you have like this ones, they have good probe tips, then you can connect on here, connect on there, then you can, if you back to the right. Screwdriver, you can change the resistance, and you see here it goes from 100 and it goes very nice to zero, and then the meter is ranging. And the things you have to look out for, it was at 61. The things you have to look out for is this is just a zero position, so it doesn't come very, it's to extend that one. As far as I just looked at it. And this is another one. These are more suspect because they're always used and they're on the outside, so they often get bumped and then they can deform. And here you see a very nice example about how not to solder. And I think it's a bit hard to see, but it's that they are completely around. They're just little chicken eggs. There are only the mounting pins for the trim pot. They are not having an electronic connection, so it does not matter very much. But better do it right. This, if you're busy with it, did I solder all those joints? Before I put it together again, I will always look it under the scope first, if that I haven't forget something or overlooked something. And if there are so not much solder joints like this here, then it's often just sandy to redo them all, and you don't even have to check them. But it's better to check them, because if you really find a mistake, then you know that was a mistake and not something you fixed by accident. This potentiometer should be 5K, and it's not a precision thing. Most important thing is that it conducts both sides. This is 500 ohms and this is 6K. The other one had also around 6K, but it was 5K printed on top of it. It only makes the range bigger. And then the important thing is to contact two of them and look if that you can. 6K, 4, 3. Yep, yes, okay. So that's just an easy check to be sure your resistors are good. And I was noticing there was a lot of gunk in between those things. This is to the outside of the instrument, and if it's used in industrial surroundings, there always can be a lot of things inside that they don't have to be there. I have repaired a scope once, and when I opened it, there was sand and little rocks coming out of it. So probably it was also industrially used. It was in a very dusty surrounding. They used it to make lasers, repair lasers on site. So and the fan had swallowed all the things, and that gave also problems. The main problems were just mechanical. A lot of broken solder joints, and so this one I can't remember if I did it. Best way then is to redo it. It's less work than taking the video and watching if I already did it. And a good solder joint is hollow like this. If it's like that, then it's wrong. It didn't flow nice, and there's a lot of those on this fluke. It's not really fluke worthy. But here was a lot of gunk, and this is normally also a suspected area because there's an angle between it. But I've looked at it under a high magnification, and it's okay. And these are things that if you lose them and try to solve them, then you just have not exacted the same location, and then you get problems. But it's not too hard here. They've made it for another trim pot. Maybe if for some sensors they don't have enough for one. This does not look on it. It looks a bit funny. And that is with an oscilloscope, you always have to look if you can not only look it from the upside, also look it from the sides, because then you see can see things you otherwise not see. Also, changing the light will make difference if you're soldering things. There's a video from the signal pad that's just uploaded where he shows some USB microphones, and one of them microscopes. One of them can do something with the lighting, and if he turns it, you see a lot of details vanishing and coming up. Very nice, very expensive microscope. This one I used was also not very cheap, but that when they sold those, the USB microscopes were not very usable yet, and the things he showed were over 1,000 euros. But one of them with the spare tablet was really great. If money was no point, I think I would go for Mantis. But on the other hand, the thing the signal pad shows can be looks very nice. The problem only with a stereo microscope, the problem, there's no problem. The field depth is good from this one, I can solder on it. And it can zoom in continue, not in steps. But it is always a big thing that is in the way, and the USB scopes are not. The advantage, however, I didn't solder that, but I first wanted to see it. The advantage is that you have more depth. It looks more real, so you know how far your soldering iron is from the pad. And I got a loop glasses, and they do that a lot less as the microscope. And I think that the new USB microscope has the same problem. You if you work under it, you can't see how close you are to the PCB, and that can be difficult. If you must be careful not to melt other parts nearby. I can see it. Let's add a little solder, don't burn your fingers, and use a desolder sucker, and a air filter thingy that sucks away the damps from the solder, because they're not very healthy. Do those two. Looking a bit black, and this one is now. Sometimes it helps if you see that it is a little bit not in the right shape, just to let it flow, reflow. Sometimes I like to use a hot soldering iron. I've this one always almost turned up to the max, 450 degrees, so I can solder very quick some things. And I do that for over 10 years or so. I'm used to that, but my pace, my other station is at set, always the soldering iron around 350 or so. The desoldering 380, 320, depends on the type of PCB and the size of the air, the round planes. It's not a problem with this, because it's double sided, no ground planes, so it's easy to solder, and it always it makes sense to see if it is on both sides, if it is soldered. There are vias inside it, but if you have damaged PCBs, PCB where someone with not so good the soldering gun was working on, then you can get a problem that the vias are ripped apart, and the soldering goes inside by capillary working the solder, and if the via is broken inside, then it only fills, if you are not lucky, it only fills the underside of the via, and it does not do the other side, and so there is no connection between the top trays and the bottom trays. And sometimes, the first time I noticed something, when I was just into electronics, it was Tektronix, and I replaced the main capacitors because they were bad in Tektronix 465. And after that, it did not work anymore. So I was searching and measuring, and it did not make sense until I found out that the modern caps I used, the older ones were big and they had three lugs, and the modern one was much smaller and only had two soldering joints. So I took the two that fitted the best and soldered them, but it turned out that the connection what I didn't use, it had no via in between, and there was, because it was ripped out, and there was no connection because there was no pin in solid, so there was one trace, the power was coming into the power supply but not out of it. So I soldered the wire from the top to the bottom to connect the pads, and after then it worked again. But there are always things to be careful with. Don't mess up the PCB. Just lifting a trace is easy to repair. Pulling a via into is not a problem if you can solder on the upper side and the bottom side. But if you can't because there is the legs are under it, like from a relay, then you really have a problem. If you need the connection on the top side too. What will help if there is some space is to take a strand of wire and put it next to the pin and scrap a bit of trace off on the top and bottom side and connect that wire to it. It is only possible if there are not going high currents between it. But it connects the traces together and it presses to the pin of the IC and of the component, and that also, if you solder it, that solders together, so then you get not only the wire forming the connection but also the soldering. So that works, but better not to damage it up front. So this one is okay. Now I will put them on the microscope and then we will put these things together, and I will look if the DC offset works, and then we can replace everything and test if all things work, because I can connect everything but the bridge is not connected to the, so yeah. The next thing I do is testing the wires. Clipped one part of the meter on the wire, in this case the white one. The white one goes here to the Hall sensor, and then I move the wires around and to see if I got some sounds I don't want, like here, some scratching. That you can do that only with a multimeter if it's fast enough, of course, because if it's very slow, it won't work. Yep. It helps if we put the switch open. Yep. And I can see the resistance on this meter, and it stays around a half ohm, and that's okay. the black one, that is this one. That has a better resistance, but also is going to the cable. Depends on where you grab it. Then we have a black one, and then the white one. White one we already tested. The yellow one. The yellow one is also going to the switch. So hook up. Yep. The switch itself. The resistance is also often a smart thing to do. I've once had a oil bath, a dry well, and that did all sorts of strange things. And then I found out that the resistance of the power switch was very high. So there was 230 on the outside of the cabinet, on the coming from the wall, but there was only something like 80 volts or so coming in the secondary. So after the power switch, so it was almost impossible to draw enough current, and then all strange things happened. And I once had it with a transmitter. The power cord was so oxidized from the inside that if you pulled it in the wall, there was only a few volts coming out on the other side, and it looked like it was completely dead, but it wasn't. It was just a dead power cord. So these ones are good. These ones are much harder to test because the most connections are on the inside and you can't reach it. Maybe you can, but if there's no need, I will not open it because I don't have manuals and I don't know what to expect. I think it's just the sensor sitting there. And you can't repair them, only some broken wires. So I pull all the wires, and with the other one, when I pulled the white one, and I had it hanging loose. It was only under the rubber socket, not solid anymore. So now we put it further apart. So before I put it together, I clean up the contacts. There is no green stuff on here, but they are a bit dirty. I use abrasive paper here. That's a grain of 2000, so it's almost paper, because you don't want a lot of scratches. I rather use a fiber pen normally, but they don't sell the one I always used anymore, and the new ones I got, they lose their hairs when you are using it, and they jump around everywhere. You get them on your hands and in your face, and that is terrible. You are scratching yourself the whole week because of those things. And I now just glue a piece of that paper on a stick. It's on paper glue. It's not dried yet. It's just and it is very, very gentle, because I have to go over it a lot of times just to remove that bit of corrosion that is on there. You want to have it shiny and not rough, because then a lot of dirt gets in between it and you have less surface to make contact. The surface is bigger, but the contact surface is smaller. The surface for dust, etc., is bigger. So, yeah, this one, you can pull them out and you have to be careful that the things here are, I don't know if you can see it, those things there, they, if they are becoming too flat, the thing is dropping out again, so then you can use a little plier and twist them a little bit out again so they bite freshly. Okay, this is good. This one is in less nice condition. Just lose the wire and then put it out. And this one is dirty. It's not green, it's a bit rusty. And little small traces of green here. Not so much, I have to dump it in the vinegar. I will do the other one too. It's a bit boring to watch. Telling the whole story, and then I found out that the camera was not on. Put the batteries in, I connected everything together, and now it's time to see if the DC offset works. And it is a potentiometer here, and if I can turn it, I could turn it from plus 34 millivolts up to minus 34 millivolts. It's nice in the middle, and the other one is not in the middle, so I have to adjust some things. But we see that it's a bit hard to connect everything if the clamp is not put together. And so, yeah, wires, you can put them on each other, and it's still possible to get a zero. So that part is working, and if that part is working, the rest probably is too. So I will mount it first, because measuring current like this is not very handy. And now if we have it together, we will test it. So it's back together again, and now you see on the camera, on the meter, if you can see it, I think like this, it's 9.7 9.70, 9.74, 9.62, 9.58. So you see every time it's now a nice constant value, and I use 10 times the wire, because the thing that is now running draws 1 amp, and if you take 10 loops, then you get a reading of 9.7, that is 9.7 amps, because with these huge things, if you connect it just around one wire, then it has a lot of trouble measuring that. If I take it in the middle, it's not bad, it's still dropping 1.1 amps. That's impressive. I wouldn't have expected that. Often the noise is too high for measuring something right. But it is very sensitive for the location. And the offset, you see that the noise is already half an amp. It's counting back. It's true RMS meter. So, succeeded. Now we have to test them on real calibrators, but that will be something for tomorrow, and they have to warm up first, and then they come back to their owners, and then I have 2 scopes to do. Hope you liked it, and see you in the next video.